Hey guys, welcome to this little mini series masterclass, part one, on how your music gets to the screen. Today's esteemed guest is Ron Bartlett, one of the best, if not living legends, actually a better term for him, re-recording dub engineers we have. Incredibly talented guy who's sharing 20 minutes of his time with you for free. It's an incredible video with incredible insight. You want to grab a pencil. Just to be clear, for those of you who don't know what the dub is also called the final mix, not the final music mix, the final mix where you have your music, the sound effects, the production dialogue, the clean ADR recorded dialogue, all comes together to create the sonic landscape of your movie or show. That's what Ron does. He's a re-recording mixer. His insight into this process from his perspective is incredible. I mean, I've been doing this a long time and I even learned things. You're gonna want to take notes on this one. So part one, the dub with Ron Bartlett. Without further ado, over to Ron.
Good morning, my name's Ron Bartlett. I'm a re-recording mixer. And Trevor's asked me a couple questions about, you know, what could I tell young composers that could help them get their mix to speak in a final mix, their compositions. I'd say the first thing would be is to listen to the dialogue. Quite often composers turn off the dialogue and they compose their music and the music sounds great, and by the time you put it in to the track with the dialogue, it ends up being turned down or ducked in certain areas that you might not like. The biggest thing I could say is to listen to it and accept it like a lead vocal track in a pop song, if you will. So if you're hearing the dialogue and you're composing around it, you'll have a much better chance of letting your music speak in the film and have a much better voice and tell the story. I mean, that's what we're really all about, right? We're all trying to tell a story. So if you accept that and put that in with your music, it'll just flow better, it'll have the right pacing, it'll speak better in the mix, you know, the whole thing is going to be a lot better and easier for all of us, including your director. Because, you know, actors are there, they're not going anywhere, you know, so everyone wants to hear what they got to say. You travel through the story with an actor, and so why not accept that and put it in, integrate it with your music better? I know it's tough, you know, when you're trying to compose music and you have a certain rhythm and the things, you know, a lead line will come in and you want a melody and it's going to do this and that. I've written music myself. I understand. I've done a little composing, not near as much as maybe some of you. So I understand the problems. But I've mixed a lot of movies, and that's one of the biggest things is not allowing the dialogue to have its space. So when you come in with a line or a certain hit or a big dramatic moment and it's not timed right, or it's just, you know, stepping on a line, I'm gonna have to turn it down. And then no one likes that, because you're like, I don't like it either, because it feels like, oh, he ducked for the dialogue, you know. And my job is to make sure that you don't feel any of that. You don't feel, like my partner like to say, we don't like to smell mixing, right? So I don't want to have to duck music and just to hear dialogue. I want to be able to integrate it and have it flow properly through the scene. And that's a big issue. So if you can turn on the dialogue, listen to it, compose your music, keep it on if you can. Maybe not all the time, but certainly when you're mixing it down and you're trying to make stems and you think about it, like, okay, my entrance there, could it be softer or smoother and be stealthy when it comes in? So maybe you want to put like a light string or a pad that just starts so you can kind of sneak in out of nowhere instead of just coming in with a melody. You know, work on those transitions that allow you to be smoother with what you're doing. And, you know, a lot of times you want to be, you know, stealthy might not be the right word, but you know, something that integrates into the mix really easily and it just kind of fits like a glove. So think about the dialogue, think about the pacing of the scene and see where that, you know, maybe that can help you, you know, with how it fits together. Because ultimately they're all going to have to play together, dialogue, music, and sound effects. So the problem is when you're composing, you're not really hearing the sound effects unless you happen to get a temp track or something that would really help. Another issue is are like hits and moments, like let's say, you know, there's it's a chase scene and everything's going and people are talking and the cars are crashing and people are shooting at each other and all that stuff. Very busy, a lot going on. Compose less, like make it much more transparent, because you don't have to carry the whole scene. If you're thinking about all those other sounds going on, you don't have to add up so many layers and put such a dense track in that, that no one else can play in the sandbox. So really think about what's going on in the scene that is not part of your part, you know, the music. So if you can think of, okay, there's going to be a car skid and then it crashes and it explodes, right? They're going to play an explosion. They're going to play the skid, the crash, all that stuff, and or someone yelling. Do you need to hit every moment and make a big sting on the explosion? Probably not. You know, build it up, build the tension, get it to the point, and then pause, and then the thing explodes, then come in with, you know, maybe sad music or whatever it is that you do for the scene. But the point is, pace it out and see where the other pieces might fit in your head. And chances are that's going to help you with the way that the pacing goes, who plays when, so that they all kind of go together. And that's really my job, is to put them all together and balance them all out so that it feels like a movie. But what you can do is help yourself, help me, help your director by pacing that stuff out, making entrances really smooth and nice and seamless, and working around dialogue. So if they're talking and you can wait and then come in with a melody or a little counterline or something like that, those little entrances are really key. And it works so much better if they're just have a natural pace with dialogue. And then if you can avoid certain moments, you know, that you know that are going to get hit by sound effects or other things, you're not going to get into that competing problem that everyone talks about, like, oh, music versus sound effects. It's not versus, it's playing with, and they play together. That's the key, is that everybody plays together to make a really cool track. So, well, let's see, what else can we do? Oh, get a good music editor, a good one. Because a lot of times this person is overlooked and they have a major role in what happens to your music. You'll be in your room, you compose the whole thing, and you go out and score it, and it gets mixed down, and off it goes to the stage, and you never see it again until the final playback. That's usually how it works, you know, because hopefully you're on to your next gig, right? So, who's handling your music? Who's this the voice on the stage that's supporting and, you know, kind of defending what it is that you did? Your music editor. So he's really the guy who's your representative. He's going to talk to me, the re-recording mixer, and mainly your director, and work it out with everything that you've done and fit it into the film. Now, obviously, he has technical, you know, things to do, like cut the track in sync and make sure, you know, all the parts are there and, you know, and the formats are right and all that kind of stuff. But his major role is doing changes, and after you're done, they've cut up the picture, and all of a sudden either you have to rescore it, or maybe there's no time, or you're on another gig, or there's all kinds of reasons, but that guy or woman is gonna save you, you know. And the way they do that is cutting up your score and making it work, and, you know, repurposing things, moving things around. I've been on dubs where I couldn't even believe what they pulled off. I mean, they've cut up stuff that you had no idea and it was never intended to be there, and it works brilliantly. And all of a sudden, oh, what a great score. The composer's great. And the editor had saved their ass big time. So look for a good one. Ask around. Make sure you have a really good voice, a representative that can really follow your score and know what your ideas, your intentions were to get you to that finish line. They're a major part. So that's a big one. Let's see. Let's talk about stems. So if you don't know what stems are, they're split outs of your mix. So you'll get, let's say you have an orchestral score and a synth score together. It's a combo, a hybrid score. So you'll have food groups, you'll have strings, you'll have samples, you'll have brass, you'll have percussion, synth sounds, all these sorts of elements, right? Percussion. Separate them out, because when it comes time for me to mix them into the film, it's not just one level that goes up and down and, oh, the dialogue's talking, everything goes down. The sound effect needs to play big there. The whole track goes down or up. You know, it's just not elegant at all. It's going to be a real problem. When I get a lot of stems, I would rather have too many than too little, personally. Sometimes you're under a time constraint and you don't have time to, like, you know, have a million stems and deal with all that. I understand it's tough, especially with budgets. But the more you split it out, the better it is for me. To take those stems and shape them properly in the mix. And what I mean by that is I'm not changing your ideas. I'm not in there going, oh, I like this better and I think it should do this or that. What I'm trying to do is fit your music into the movie with the proper levels that can I can play more of your music. And what I mean by that is, like, let's say you have a track and you have a line that comes in and then a lot of percussion comes in and the dialogue's there. So do I have to lower everything together the same? No. I can take certain elements that might be fighting with the dialogue or with maybe a sound effect or something. I can just lower that a little, keeping the rest of your idea up and keeping the integrity of the music up. That's a huge deal. And it's in every movie, every composer from Hans Zimmer to anybody else you can think of. They all split out stems, and I'm very thankful when they do that. And people like Alan Meyerson, who I've worked with a lot, and he's one of the best. He'll tell you the same thing, you know, make stems. And then it makes my job way easier, and it helps your director a lot. The other thing that does is help your music editor. And by that, I mean the music editor is going to take all these stems. He's going to have everything playing that you intended to be there. And then when it comes time to make those changes I talked about, he's going to have to take, or she will have to take those stems and cut them up and maybe move things around and take things that you didn't really mean to be there, but he's going to put it in there in a really creative way and make it work with a transition that you never saw. So if the timing or the picture changed, or, you know, maybe they took out half your cue, do you really want them to just cut right in the middle of your line, your melody, and cut it in half? You know, it's not going to be elegant. It's going to suck. So having those stems separate allows your music editor to repurpose things, to move things around, to take things in and out, to make it more musical, make the edit much better, and help the movie flow. So it helps everyone, really, if you can do that. I know there is a lot of composers out there that don't like people changing their music. They don't like them rebalancing anything. And I understand that. I understand, as a composer myself, sometimes, you know, that I don't want someone changing my idea. But that's not really the purpose of that. The purpose is for us to help you make those changes happen, and, you know, help out your music. We're there to help you and support you and not change your ideas and mess things up. Blade Runner 2049, there's a prime example, is Ben Wolfish and Hans wrote a lot of great music, really great stuff. The whole idea was, they came on late in the game because there was a change in composer. So they didn't have the time and the luxury of, you know, laying everything out, going over the, having it all approved, all that stuff. So Ben decided to write a lot of two-channel parts, you know, that all added up to this great score. If you've heard it, it's amazing. The idea was that it would be overbuilt a bit. So what I mean is that they had decided to write some extra parts and different sounds so that Denis, our director, could hear them on a stage and then say, okay, I like this, I don't like that, or, you know, and adjust things and take things in and out. So I had all these different sounds, you know, all separated. It was very unique. Usually things are mixed in, like, okay, here's, you know, 10 or 15 5/1 stems or 7/1 stems. Here's your strings, here's your brass, here's your percussion, all that. I didn't have that. I had a few like that, and a lot of them were just left, right, just a stereo mix of whatever synth sounds or percussion or things that he had. In doing that, we pieced together and heard all these sounds and found out what Denis was really liking and some things that he didn't like throughout the film. So we were able to pick and choose what the director liked on the stage and build those together. And then once we had the core of all the music that Denis liked, I had the chance to really spread things around the room, and it was in Atmos, so we could go to town with it. I had everything at my fingertips because I could get to any track. That was the extreme. That was an unusual circumstance. If you have things split into certain food groups, that helps me, helps the director, helps your music editor, and ultimately helps you and your music get it heard in the mix. So those are the biggest things I could think of. Let's see. Don't be too precious with your music. Everyone writes something that hopefully that they really love, and they want that to be, you know, not messed with, and it's in the movie and it's going to be brilliant. We all want that. Everyone does. Sometimes, like I said, there's a lot of picture changes and you can't play what you wrote. You know, we're going to have to change it. We're going to have to do stuff to it. We're going to have to move it around, repurpose it, do whatever we can to help you out. And a lot of times that means big changes. So work with your music editor and figure that out, you know, and maybe you have to rescore something, but hopefully if you have your stems and you have other stems from other cues or other reels, work with your music editor and get those together. Then you can swap things out, move things around. We do it on every single film. It's just always happens. Because it's so rare that we'll actually get a film that's done, nobody touches it, you score it, then I get it. It just doesn't happen. Even on the movie I'm doing now, I'm dealing with this really... I don't know if you've ever heard of him. He's a really... touchy composer, some guy named Beethoven, right? And he doesn't want his music messed with, and he doesn't give you any stems either. So it's a documentary on Gustavo Dudamel, and it's all about him composing and teaching kids and showing what he does with that composition. But in a way, he's doing the same thing as he is storytelling within the composition. So you get to really see an insight on that. What happens is, you know, he's conducting in big orchestras all around the world, in Germany and in Caracas and Venezuela. Works with kids, works with, you know, adult, you know, players. And then he approaches everything within that music and pulls out all the great parts within it, and you hear stuff and you're like, wow, that's amazing. But it's the same piece of music we've all heard for years. So think about that. That's another aspect of how he can get emotion out of certain parts that maybe you didn't think of. So there's that. There's all kinds of things that you can do with your music within the film to tell a story, because ultimately that's what we all do, is we help the director tell his story in the film. Everything we do should be about that and not about what I do in my little, department. I get all the departments, they all come together to me, and I have to balance out everybody. So that's kind of my problem, is that I have to work out how everything fits together. Your music is a major part of it. What you do is sort of the emotional content of the film, if you will. You deal with emotions, you deal with pacing, dynamics, all kinds of these great tools to help a film. But ultimately, it tells a story. The actors are telling a story. Even sound effects tell a story. They all help. Everybody puts their two cents in and makes this amazing collaborative art. It's one of the most collaborative art forms out there. And what we do in the sound department is, it's very odd. It's a very unique gig. And what it is intangible. So you sit there and you watch a movie, but you only hear what we do. You can't see it. You don't know what's going on. You just feel it. So go with that. Go with the feeling. Really, figure out what it is you're trying to do telling that story. Help out who's going to take it from there, which is your music editor and then ultimately me. And we will then put it together with the director and really help your music tell that story. I hope all this helped, and if you have questions or whatever, get in touch with Trevor, and I'd love to answer some, I hope that helped you out. Thanks so much.